Working now.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وآله وصحبه أما بعد Dear brothers and sisters, dear guests, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We'll continue our talk today regarding Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. And as I mentioned last week, Al-Isra refers to a journey by night on planet Earth. Al-Mi'raj means ascension into heaven. And I mentioned that in Surah Al-Isra, chapter 17, or Surah Bani Israel, the children of Israel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in verse 1, and it's only mentioned once in the whole Quran. Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi laylan min al-masjid al-harami ila al-masjid al-aqsa alladhi barakna hawla linuriyahu min ayatina innahu as-sami'u al-basir. Glory be to the one who took his servant, body and soul, on a journey by night from the sacred mosque in Mecca to al-masjid al-aqsa, the farthest mosque in Jerusalem, in order to show him some of our signs. إِنَّهُ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ Sami'a means the one who hears, Basir means the one who can see. And I also mentioned that in this verse, there were glad tidings to the Prophet that there will be, that the mosque, the grand mosque or the sacred mosque in Mecca will be purified, because at that time, they had 360 idols there, and the idol worshippers had control over the mosque. The time will come when this will be purified, and there will be a mosque also in Jerusalem. And Al-Qasi, which refers, if you talk about in Arabic Al-Aqsa, farthest, then there is farther, and it refers also to Masjid Al-Madinah, the Prophet's mosque in Medina. So in this one verse, it tells us about three mosques which are going to be established. What was the name of the year in which this journey took place? Am al-huzn. What does it mean in English? Sadness and sorrow. Why was it known as the year of sadness or sorrow? What happened? Yeah, exactly. Khadija died, radiallahu anha, and his uncle, who was a great supporter, died. Prophet ﷺ suffered a lot from the boycott by Quraysh and the sanctions imposed upon the Muslims at that time, and so on. So he was going through very, very hard and difficult times. And as you all know, it was it took place around 11 years and 9 months. Yeah. When the Prophet ﷺ started his mission, let me give you the exact date. Can I have this? Thank you. Let me give you the exact date. There are different opinions which says it happened in Sha'ban, it happened in Rajab, it happened in Rabi' al-Awwal. The majority of the scholars agree it happened during the month of Rajab. And it took place 11 years and 9 months after the beginning of the mission of the Prophet ﷺ. I also mentioned last week the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem, which happened twice. And maybe next Friday or maybe this Friday, if I have the time to go through more details in the same chapter. It's very important to know the history of our religious sites and religious monuments, where there are other people who are trying to The word in Arabic is tams. Yatmus means to completely erase our ownership of such sites and claim it belongs to them rather than belonging to us. I'm going to cover a few or to talk about a few hadith here. Last week, you may recall, I mentioned the hadith of Prophet ﷺ while he was on his journey. He was asked by Jibreel alayhi salam to go down and pray. Where did you pray? I don't know. You prayed in Tiba, you prayed in Medina. One of the names of Medina is Tiba, and you are going to immigrate to it. They continue with their journey. Go down and pray. Where did you pray? I don't know. that was Mount Sinai, where Allah spoke to Moses, carry on, go down and pray. Where did you pray? I don't know. You prayed in Bethlehem, where Isa alayhi salatu wasalam was born, and then they entered Jerusalem. So on the way from Mecca to Jerusalem, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam stopped three times to offer prayers. And this shows us the oneness of the God. Only one religion, only one God. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam was reminded of the importance of Mount Sinai, and the importance of Bethlehem, and the importance of Medina, and so on. We also mentioned a hadith regarding a genie who had a flame or a torch in his hand, and he was directing it into the face of the Prophet ﷺ. And every time he turns in any direction, the genie would put the torch in his face. And then Jibreel alayhi salam told the Prophet certain invocation or certain words. If you say it, he said to him, if you say it, the genie will fall on his face and his torch will be extinguished, which he did. Today I will cover other hadith, and I'll start with all these ahadith are sahiha, because the source is sound, the source is right. Let me start with this one. When the Prophet ﷺ went on his journey of Mi'raj, he says, according to this hadith in al-Tirmidhi, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet ﷺ said, I met Ibrahim the night I went on my journey. He saw Ibrahim عليه الصلاة والسلام, and Ibrahim said to the Prophet, يا محمد, O Muhammad, اقرأ أمتك مني السلام. Give my salam to your ummah. It's a greeting from Ibrahim to the ummah of Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام. وأخبرهم أن الجنة طيبة التربة عذبة الماء. And tell them that paradise has a fertile soil and very fresh and sweet water. وأنها قيعان, is very spacious, huge. وأن غراسها, and what they can plant there in such fertile, spacious soil with sweet water. Subhanallah. الحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر. And in another narration, ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. This is very interesting, because you can imagine every time you say that, you would expect, inshallah, when Allah will forgive all us and we hope to enter paradise, inshallah, that you will find these trees waiting for you there. Because you used to say, you used to remember Allah all the time by saying, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wa la akbar, wa la hawla, wa la quwwata illa billah al-ali al-azim. And if you read Surah Al-Kahf, chapter 18, verse 46, it says, Al-malu wal-banuna zinatul hayatid dunya. Wealth and boys or sons are the allurement of this life. But al-baqiyatu al-salihat, what remains? The good things which remains are better in the sight of Allah. And in the tafsir it says, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. Let me read this. But the good righteous deeds that last are better with your Lord for reward and better for hope. Ibn Abbas said, and others among the Salaf said, that the good righteous deeds that last are the five daily prayers. Ata ibn Abi Rahab and Sa'd ibn Jubair narrated from Ibn Abbas, the good righteous deeds that last are Subhanallah, glory to Allah, Alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah, La ilaha illallah, there is none worthy of worship except Allah, and Allahu Akbar, Allah is the most great. والباقيات الصالحات, the good righteous deed that last. Again, another interpretation here is, this is the celebration of the remembrance of Allah, saying La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Astaghfirullah, and so on. jihad, maintaining ties of kinship, and all other good deeds are also good righteous deeds, which are more important than material things which are being given to us in this life. The next hadith actually is very interesting, but Al-Albani said that it is da'if, it is weak. However, a weak hadith doesn't mean I don't talk about it, or I don't examine it, or I don't study it, especially when it talks about manners or about etiquettes. But when it talks about fiqh or aqidah, then we will not use it in our studies. And this hadith is, the Prophet ﷺ says, while I was traveling on my journey into heaven, I smelled something very nice. So I asked Jibreel, I said, Jibreel, I can smell something so beautiful. What is it? And he said, هَذِهِ رَائِحَةٌ, this is the smell of the woman who used to brush the hair of the daughter of Pharaoh and her children. So it's the smell of the woman who used to brush the hair of the daughter of Pharaoh and the smell of her children. So Prophet ﷺ asked about وَمَا شَأْنُهَا, what about her? What happened? Why we are experiencing this beautiful smell? And he said, one day she was brushing the hair of this princess, and she and the comb fell from her, or the brush fell from her hand. So she said, Bismillah, and picked it up. So the daughter said, this princess said, do you mean my father? She said, no, your father is not God. I mean the Creator. She said, do you mind if I tell my father about this? She said, no, you can't tell your father. So the girl went and told her father. You know that Pharaoh at that time was the only Pharaoh who claimed to be God on earth. أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى, I am your Lord, the Most High. مَا عَلِمْتُ لَكُم مِّنْ إِلَهٍ غَيْرِهِ, I don't know any other God but me. So what happened? Pharaoh called the woman. Do you believe in another God besides me? She said, yes, you're not God. I believe in the one true God. So he brought her children, and he commanded for a bath of melting brass. And he threatened her, if you don't change your mind, I will throw your children one by one in front of your eyes. And he did. And the woman did not change her mind. She said to him, I have only one request, that you combine all our bones together and you bury them together. That's all. And then, according to this hadith, it says, the last child was still being breastfed, and she was carrying the child, and she was about to change her mind from what she experienced. And then Allah made this baby speak to her, and he said, Ya Umma Iqtahimi, O my mother, jump in. فَإِنَّ عَذَابَ الدُّنْيَا أَقَلُّ مِنْ عَذَابِ الْآخِرَةِ, because the punishment in this life is nothing compared to the punishment on the day of judgment. So she jumped in. The next hadith the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he heard when he entered the garden or paradise, he heard a sound, footsteps of someone. Could you please move forward, everybody? Please. There's a lot of people out there. Please. So when he entered, he heard a sound. فَسَمِعَ مِنْ جَانِبِهَا وَجَسًا. He heard a sound, like footsteps. He said, oh, Jibreel, what is that? I can hear footsteps. He said, هذا بلال المؤذن. This is Bilal who gives the adhan. You know, Bilal was a black African who was sold as a slave. And Abu Bakr bought him and gave him his freedom. And the Prophet ﷺ appointed him as مؤذن الرسول. Big difference. He was assigned, the title was مؤذن الرسول. That was his title. And Islam taught us there is no discrimination among people because of their color or because of their race or because of their ethnicity. Prophet ﷺ clearly states there is no difference between an Arab and an Arab, except by righteousness. And Allah says this, I have created you all from a single pair of a male and female and made you all into nations and tribes to get to know each other. Surely the most honored of you in the akramakum عند الله أتقاكم. The most honored of you in the sight of Allah is the righteous. Not the Pakistanis, not the Arabs, not the Indians, not the Bangladeshis. No, no. This is a sign that Allah exists, that we have different colors and different tongues. Remember that. Don't you dare to claim that they are better because I'm an Arab. I'm Egyptian. I'm an Arab. Allah appeared in Sinai. He didn't appear anywhere else. It's glory. Prophet ﷺ had an Egyptian wife and an Egyptian grandmother. In Egypt, we had most of the prophets of Allah. So I'm better than anyone else. No. No. Nobody can claim that. You cannot judge others and you cannot judge yourself. Leave Allah to decide who is the righteous. So Bilal was so close to the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet ﷺ, when he went back after his journey, he said, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ بِلَال. Surely Bilal has succeeded. Bilal has excelled. I heard his footsteps in the Jannah. In the next hadith, the Prophet ﷺ saw people whose lips and tongues were pulled out with tweezers made out of fire. Can you imagine how horrible it is? A tweezer made out of fire, pulling the lips and the tongues of these people. So Prophet ﷺ asked Jibreel, قلت من هؤلاء? Who are these, Jibreel? He said, خطباء من أهل الدنيا. These are preachers in this life who used to command people to do good, but they forgot about themselves. They were hypocrites. They were saying to people, don't steal, and they steal. Don't lie, and they lie. Don't cheat, and they cheat, and so on. So the verse in the Quran is in chapter 2, verse 44. أَتَأْمُرُونَ النَّاسَ بِالْبِرِّ وَتَنْسَوْنَ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ تَتْلُونَ الْكِتَابِ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Do you command people to do goodness and you forget about yourself whilst you are reading the book? You have no sense? You have no mind? أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Another hadith, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I passed by people who had very long nails made out of brass. And they were scratching their faces and scratching their chests. So he asked Jibreel, who are these? He said, those are the backbiters and the slanderers. Can you imagine? When you backbite someone, you are eating his dead flesh. And on the day of judgment, you'll have these nails made out of brass and you will be scratching your face and your chest because you used to slander this woman or this man and used to backbite the people around you. These are some of the ayat, the signs which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam experienced. What was the most important thing which was ordained on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam during the journey of Isra and Mi'raj? Who can tell me? As-salah. Right, exactly. Exactly. So let me read this hadith in Sahih Muslim. It's a very interesting. Okay. It's a long hadith, but we need to cover it very quickly. In the next 5 minutes. The Prophet ﷺ in this hadith is giving us an account for the whole journey from the very beginning. From the very beginning. When he says, Al-Buraq was brought to me, and we said Al-Buraq was just an animal. The name was given from the speed of the lighting. Speed of light, who can tell me the speed of the light? I never remember it. 186,000 miles per second, yeah? Or 300,000 kilometers per second. This is the speed of the light. Speed of the light. You can imagine the speed in which the Prophet ﷺ was traveling at. Because when he came back, his bed was still warm. All this happened, and when he came back, his bed was still warm. So, he went on this animal, and he traveled. And when he arrived into Jerusalem, فَرَبَطَّهُ بِالْحَلَقَ الَّتِي يَرْبُطْ بِهِ الْأَنْبِيَةِ. Okay. Today, if you go to Jerusalem and you look at the Temple Mount, you will see a wall known now as the Western Wall. The Western Wall. It has great significance or importance to our Jewish brothers and sisters. Great, great importance. It used to be called Ha'itul Mabka, the Wailing Wall. Now it is called the Western Wall. We call it Ha'itul Buraq. It is the only part remained from the temple. Ha'itul Buraq. This is where the Prophet ﷺ parked his vehicle. And he says that, I tied this animal to the ring where the prophets before me used to park there. And what's the relevance? What is the relevance to tell me that he parked his vehicle there in that place? What do you think? Where did you park your car today? In front of one of the houses there, and you blocked the entrance? So did you park your car properly? What's the relevance? Think about it. A very important hadith in Sahih Muslim talking about Isra and Mi'raj and talking to Allah and starting the 50 daily prayers reduced to 5, and then Muhammad alayhi wasallam is telling me, فَرَبَطُوهُ بِالْحَلَقَةِ الَّتِي يَرْبُطْ بِهَا الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. Do you know why? Because we are very disorganized people. I was in Spain last week or 2 weeks ago, and the Imam said exactly the same thing, honestly. He said, our neighbors are complaining that you are parking your cars in the wrong place. I said, oh my goodness. Even in Marbella and South Woodford, everywhere we go, the Muslims are a cause of nuisance. And the Prophet tells us in this hadith, authentic hadith, in Sahih Muslim, that he was so careful. He didn't just dump it there and he left it. And no, it is very important. You are coming to collect air miles. Don't lose the reward from Allah because you don't care about the others. No. Anyway, so Jibreel brought a glass with wine and another one with milk. That's in this hadith. Other hadith talks about water as well. فَقَالَ Jibreel, so the Prophet ﷺ chose the milk. He had milk and he had wine. He chose the milk. So Jibreel said, اخْتَرْتَ الْفِطْرَ, you have chosen the good nature. فطرة الله التي فطر الناس عليها. Verse 30, chapter 30. Then we started our ascension in heaven. And every time before they move from one heaven to the next, there was a protocol. They have to ask for permission to enter. There's a password. They have to key in the password, and then they will listen to a message from the guards of the heaven of that level. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and they will say, who are you? This is Jibreel. I have Muhammad with me. He has been sent, or been sent, he is a messenger, etc. So rules and regulations followed regarding moving from one heaven to the next. So Jibreel, who is with you, Muhammad? Has he received the revelation? Yes. So they open and they go in. He saw Adam in the first one. Adam welcomed him and he prayed for him. In the second one, he saw Isa and Zachariah. And then in the third one, he saw Yusuf. And in the fourth one, he saw Idris. And the fifth one, he saw Harun, and in the sixth one he saw Musa, and then the seventh one he saw Ibrahim. And then فإذا أنا بإبراهيم صلى الله عليه مسندا ظهره إلى البيت. Ibrahim was sitting there, resting his back to the البيت المعمور. البيت المعمور, you know, there is a similar thing to what we have here, a Kaaba, a house where الملأ الأعلى, the highest assembly, would actually go in and pray and come out, exactly as we do in Kaaba, something very similar there, known as البيت المعمور, the much frequented house, this visit all the time. And in this hadith, it says, يدخله كل يوم 70,000 ملك. Every day, 70,000 angels will enter it, and they will never come back to it. So you can imagine, 70,000 angels, every day, they go to this place. Then the Prophet ﷺ reached the point, Sidrat al-Muntaha, عندها جنة المأوى, that's verse 15, chapter 53, the star. And he reached the lottery beyond which none may pass. And Jibreel could not move anymore, so Prophet ﷺ had to proceed on his own. And then a conversation took place between him and Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. There was a greeting. There's a protocol. At-tahiyyatu lillah. Greetings be to Allah. So Allah said, As-salamu alayka ayuhan nabi wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May God's peace be upon you, O Prophet, and the mercy and the blessings of Allah. Prophet ﷺ responded by saying, As-salamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi as-salihin. May peace be upon us and all the righteous servants of God. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. That was the protocol, that was the beginning of the discussion which took place between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam. Jibreel was not allowed to proceed beyond this point. Only the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Did he see Allah? No. No. Nobody can see Allah. When he was asked by Aisha, he said, light upon light. I can only see light. I couldn't see light. Because you cannot see Allah with this eyes, as Musa asked to see Allah, and Allah said to him, you won't be able to see me. Look at the mountain. If it remains intact, you will be able to answer. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained on at that night 50 prayers on us. Prophet ﷺ came back. Musa said, what happened? He said, Allah ordained 50 prayers. He said, no, your people are very weak, much weaker than my people. Go back, ask for less. They went back, Allah made it 40. And the journey continued until it became 5, and the reward is 10 times, so it becomes 50. And when Musa said, ask for less, he said, no, I can't. I'm very embarrassed now to go back and talk to Allah about any more reductions. No. And from that night, it was ordained on us the 5 daily prayers. And what direction was to pray? Huh? Jerusalem. And the Qibla was Jerusalem. I think I'm going to stop here. Unfortunately, we can carry on next week. But just to mention something very, very quick. Can we have the collection, please? Sometimes people doubt the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you remember when Musa was commanded to hit the Red Sea and it split into two halves and each half was like a mountain? Can you imagine? The water is used to flow. Suddenly the water stopped. I try to imagine this. كل فرق كالطود العظيم. Each side was like a huge mountain. As I mentioned last Friday, when the knife was applied to the throat or to the head of Ismail, it didn't cut. It's normally a knife would cut. When Ibrahim was in the fire would burn, but it didn't burn Ibrahim. The whale did not digest Jonah. And Allah says, if Jonah was not one of those who remembered me very often, he would have remained in the tummy of the whale until the day of judgment. Can you imagine? Not to digest him. You remember the man who was traveling on his donkey and passed by Jerusalem when it was fully destroyed, and he questioned it, "Anna yuhi hadhi illahu ba'd?" How can Allah give life back to this city after it's been fully destroyed, and Allah made him die for 100 years, but his food remained intact for 100 years. No fridge, no freezer, the food was there. When Ibrahim asked Allah to show him how he gives life to the dead, And he got the birds and minted them, put them on the mountains and called them, came back. Don't doubt or question the power of Allah. Go back and reflect on these things. People of the cave who slept for 309 years, nothing has changed. Didn't grow hair, didn't grow nails, no pressure sores. So try to reflect on these things to help you to understand a journey like Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj and the importance of the prayers and the purification which we have to go through before we pray. Next week, inshallah, we'll try to cover more regarding this topic.
As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, brothers and sisters. There is a brother, Nadeem Butt, who is a member of the congregation. His children come here for prayers as well, for learning Quran. He's going through a very serious surgery today, brain tumor. So please pray for him. Remember, he's got a 6 or 7 hour surgery. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it successful and make it easy for the family. There is another brother who's going through a very painful event, and him and his children have been associated with this center for 20 years, or at least 15 years, if I can remember correctly. I'm going to go into a little detail for 1 minute, so that this is an alert for you all. Police raided his home on Monday. They broke the door in the morning. They chucked them out, put them away in another place, and they started searching the house. For 4 days, they were not allowed to go back home. They took one of his 18-year-old child into custody and have still not released. So the charge, the child was on internet and terror activities. So I am asking all parents here to be aware of what your children do on the internet. They may be looking at sites, they may be doing things, not knowing that this may lead to circumstances which will be horrendous for the family. So it is our responsibility as parents to ensure that our children are not involved in anything that will lead to such trouble. So please, this is my request, to remember this family in your prayers. The family is called Nawazi family. Please remember Nawazi family. May Allah make it easy for them. And whatever it is cleared, and the child comes back to the family. But it is a warning shot for all of us to be aware how and what our children are doing on the internet, on the computers, and you need to watch it. Please make them aware, and this is very, very important. I made an announcement for 3 weeks or 4 weeks continuously about an event that was going to be held in this masjid, and you are nearly 350 people, and the second salah is 350 people. There's 700 people who attended and listened to it, and I requested that please make a diary note and come to the event. It is for your benefit that we are trying to arrange this, and it will help you to learn and understand hate crime and how it can be reported, how we can address the situation. Unfortunately, we only had 12 people from our congregation members. There were other people, there were other ladies. I'm talking about men. There were about 15, 14 ladies from our congregation who came to that day. But this shows how laid back we are. We are not interested what the mosque is arranging for you. And the consequences are what you are getting here, which I just mentioned to you. So please remember that when we hold such events for you and we request you to diarize it and attend those events, it was a shame that we had arrangement for 70 people here, but only 12 of our mosque men attended, and 14 or 15 ladies attended. I am just reminding you that please appreciate the efforts that we are doing, and at least find an hour or two when we ask you once in a while. We are holding a Dora-e Quran for Ramadan, which you do every year, and it's a brief explanation of the Quran, one juz per day in Urdu for the ladies. It is going to be it's going to start from 9th of May between 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. So please inform your sisters or daughters who are free and who can come during the 9th of May onward. We will be holding this for the full 30 Jews, one Jews per day. Jazakumullah khair.
Thank you.
Prayer time, Sam.
Okay. We'll have the adhan, and then you do your sunnah, and then we'll straight do the prayer, inshallah.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح
before you start your prayers, please fill in the gaps in front of you.
Please move forward, please.
Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
Allahu Akbar.
Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah.
Ashhadu an la ilaha
illallah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadar Rasulullah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadar Rasulullah. Hayya 'ala s-salah.
La hawla wa la quwwata.
Hayya 'ala s-salah.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وآله وصحبه أما بعد فيقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في سورة الإسراء أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله لنريه من آياتنا إنه هو السميع البصير أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المؤمنين فاستغفروه إنه غفور الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وآله وصحبه أما بعد فيقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في نفس السورة وآتينا موسى الكتاب وجعلناه هدى لبني إسرائيل ألا تتخذوا من دوني وكيلا ذرية من حملنا مع نوح إنه كان عبدا شكورا صدق الله العظيم وبلغ نبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آل بيتك الطيبين الطاهرين وأزواجك أمهات المؤمنين وصحابتك الخلفاء الراشدين والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين ونحن معهم بفضلك وجودك وكرمك يا أرحم الراحمين يا رب العالمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين وأهلك أعداءك أعداء الدين اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم إنا نسألك هداك ورضاك اللهم اجعل أعمالنا في رضاك بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر وأقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا بارك في الإقامة بليز
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
Staqim, straighten your ranks, please, and fill the gaps and pray as if it is the last prayer. Remember in your sujood, your parents and those who are in difficulties and those who are not well, and those who are not with us anymore. Staqim. Allahu Akbar. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألهاكم التكاثر حتى زرتم المقابر كلا سوف تعلمون ثم كلا سوف تعلمون كلا لو تعلمون علم اليقين لترون الجحيم ثم لترونها عين اليقين ثم لتسألن يومئذ عن النعيم الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله الله أكبر أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين
آمين
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم تبت يدا أبي لهب وتب ما أغنى عنه ماله وما كسب سيصلى نارا ذات لهب وامرأته حمالة الحطب في جيدها حبل من مسد الله أكبر
سبحان الله
سمع الله لمن حمده حمدا طيبا كثيرا ونعم صالحا الله أكبر
السلام عليكم. اللهم صل على محمد.
بارك.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. استغفر الله العظيم الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم أتوب إليه. استغفر الله العظيم الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم أتوب إليه. يا أرحم الراحمين ارحمنا إنا برحمة تغنينا بها عن رحمة سواك. اللهم أنت السلام والسلام وليك أرجع السلام. تباركت يا ربنا يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. اللهم أعيننا على ذكرك وشكرك وحمدك وطاعتك. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وقال ربكم ادعوني أستجب لكم. يا رب ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. ربنا آمنا بما أنزلت واتبعنا الرسول فاكتبنا مع الشاهدين. ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما.